One, two, get down.
Yes, legends, we're back for another episode. This is 26 Podcast. I'm your host, Rogan
Paid
McJoy.
The call to be the boss. Paid the call to be the boss.
Okay, welcome to 26 Podcast again. I can't quite believe that I'm saying this, but I've got Leigh Griffiths with me. Leigh, how are you, mate?
Yeah, I'm good, mate. How are you?
I'm really, really good. Thank you so much for coming on the channel, mate. Honestly, for me, when I was setting up this podcast, to think that I've got someone who has played international football, played in the Premier League, played in the biggest games in the world, played against Messi, it's pretty surreal for me, this is. So I know it might be just sort of a normal thing for you, but for me, it's massive, and I appreciate how easily you come on. You've been wicked, so thank you very, very much.
No problem.
We're going to be going through your life and your career, mate. We're going to take it back right to the beginning. Where were you born and bred?
I was born in Edinburgh, 1990, so it seems like a long, long time ago now. just when I grew up, just all I wanted to do was play football. Parents were very, very supportive. I always had the ball at my feet. And then just, you know, growing up, it was pretty one-way sailing.
When you started playing football, did you always know that you had a special talent?
No, not really. It wasn't until I played, I think it was like under-9s or under-10s or something, and I scored like 117 goals in a season. And it was, I think my dad was saying after, he was like, you might have something special here. And I just tried to, you know, continue that. I had that mindset focus that, you know, football was always going to be the number one target.
So you joined the team when you were 9 years old. Was that your first team?
I was six.
Oh, you were six.
Yeah. Excuse me. I was 6 years old, and then it was actually by chance I started playing football because me and my dad and my little brother always used to go a walk just to the local pitches, and we were walking along watching the games, and one of the coaches asked, he's like, oh, I've seen you walking about a lot, you know, we're struggling for players today, would you mind your little boy helping us out? And my dad asked, and I was like, aye, why not? And I scored two in my debut, so two headers as well. So I'm not the tallest guy, so to score two headers was brilliant, and after that, I just kicked on.
Yeah, that's class. What age did you sort of reach that level where you were going to an academy?
So I was actually at Hibs when I was in under-11s, and then got released when I was under-12, so... Being a Hibs fan, it was a bitter pill to swallow. But after that, I was just like, you know what, just get the head down, knuckle hard, and see what opportunities happen. And it wasn't until I went back to a boys' club that I actually started enjoying it more. Obviously, the more like bigger games, and obviously you make friends and stuff, and obviously the friends I made at boys' club, I'm still friends with them now. So it's been a long road, but yeah, I think obviously the younger generation now, like, it's no point going into academy at such a young age. Just enjoy football. And my boy, he's just turned 12. He was at Dundee. He got released from Dundee, and he was heartbroken because that's the team he supports. And I just told him, look, just enjoy it. I never got picked up till I was, you know, 15, 16. So just enjoy football. Just enjoy being back. Just enjoy playing with your friends. He came over here, and he really enjoyed playing with the lads at the under 13 level here. So. Yeah, I think he's looking forward to coming back out.
Yeah, it's interesting you say that, because I was chatting to, is it Alex yesterday, yeah, who was at Liverpool, and he'd been at Liverpool right from 8, I think it was, to 16 off memory. And he said that when he got to 16, he went to America, and he said that he was just exhausted of academy life where, you know, every session you've got to be on, hard work. He was exhausted by the time he's 16. So I do think there's some truth in what you say there, where you go, you have to be a kid as well as play football, right?
Yeah, absolutely. It's like a young age, the coaches to be telling you, oh, you can't do this and you can't do that. I'm thinking, like, as kids at a young age, you're not wanting that. You want to, like, enjoy football, you know, enjoy the good weather when it comes, kicking a ball about with your mates and scoring goals and having fun. Obviously, if you get to an academy and you've got a special talent, it's completely different. But for lads like myself who just wanted to go and just enjoy football, and obviously you wanted to be a professional footballer, that was our end goal, but to go out and just enjoy and play with your mates, I don't think there's a better feeling.
Nah, definitely not. What was Hibs' reason for releasing you at under-12s?
What was the reason again? I wasn't good enough. That was it. I wasn't good enough. It was ironic because I ended up signing for Hibs on loan later on in life. like near enough 10 years later, I ended up signing for Hibs on loan for 2 years. So, but nah, like I say, I was a bitter pill to swallow because that was my boyhood club. But again, I just went back to boys club and started enjoying my football again.
I think that's important because in my experience as a player, and I was grew up in Cambridge United, and you know, there's a lot of players, you'll probably know some yourself, Leigh, where they go, right, I've been released, and they lose their way. They just completely lose interest. It's good that you found the boys club and got that fundamental of enjoying it.
Yeah, I think especially when you're under 12, you're still at that age where you can go, right, you know what, I've still got a lot of years left to enjoy boys club, and if you make it at boys club level and you're doing well, then scouts will naturally come and watch. Edinburgh was... It was big for boys clubs, two of them in particular, Hutchison Vale and Louth Athletic. They were the two massive clubs in Edinburgh, and luckily enough I got to play for both, but it wasn't until I went to Hutchison Vale that I realised how big a club they were and the players that they've produced over the years, John Collins, Darren Fletcher, guys like this. And I just thought, you know what, if you go there, scouts are naturally going to come and watch. And it was my coach at the time, Tam Smith, he came and told me that a scout from Livingston was going to come and watch. I think he came out, I'm not very sure what game he came to watch me, but obviously done something right in the game for them to ask me to go along and do the training and stuff, and it was not long after that I got signed up.
That's where you went, Livingston?
Yeah, that was my first club, yeah, Livingston. I went there, I signed under-17s when I was 15, so that must have been my June-ish time. I turned 16, so I signed my first professional contract when I was 16. In August, and made my debut off the bench in, I want to say October, for the first team.
Really, yeah.
So I went from 17s to 19s reserves, first team in 2.5 months.
Wow. So you just went there, you hit the ground running, I'm guessing, yeah?
Yeah, just scoring goals. I just, when you look back younger, just your sole focus was as a striker to go and score goals. Nowadays, it's completely changed the game.
Yeah.
But as a youngster, when you're coming through the ranks, all you want to do is score goals, and that's what I've done from game to game.
Did they do YTs then, or did you just bypass the YTs?
No, so yeah, so my professional contract was basically YTS.
Yeah.
Starting off at under 17s, and it wasn't, obviously, just when I played for the under 17s on a Friday night. I think I scored three. The under 19s coach was there on a Friday night watching the game. He asked my dad, could I come and play for the 19s on a Sunday? There was a striker shot because he was injured. I went there, scored for the 19s. And then I just trained with the 19s. Then on in, I never trained with 17s again. I think it was 2 months I was training with the 17s. Went straight to the under-19s full-time. And then obviously caught the manager's eye in the first team and started training with them and managed to make my debut. And I'm sure it was October, yeah.
What was that like, your debut?
It was weird because I never drove at the time. So I was obviously 16. There was a few of us got the bus. JB, he knows one of the guys I was travelling through with. Gordon Smith. So we always used to travel on a bus, and as a youngster, you always got jobs to do. My jobs were to clean the gaffer and assistant manager's boots. So I've done them on the Friday. I remember them doing them on the Friday because they were black copas, and I made them spotless, polished a lot. And I got a phone call from my under-19's manager saying, the gaffer wants a word with you. So I was like, okay. So he phones me, he's like, what the fuck's wrong with my boots? I was like, nothing wrong with your boots. I was like, they're sparkling. I made sure they were sparkling yesterday before I left. He said, make sure you come to my office when you get in. So I think I was only halfway through my journey, so I've got about 45 minutes to go. I'm sitting there absolutely fucking sweating, thinking, what have I done, man? The guy's killing me here. So I've walked in, he's picked up his boots, and I'm no kidding, they were sparkling. I was like, ah, look, they're lovely. he's like, I know, I wanted you to get in here. You're on the bench getting the fucking changing room. I was like, ah. So I had to phone my mum and dad and tell them, look, I'm on the bench for the first team. We ended up getting beat in the game, but, you know, just to, I think I got the last 10, 15 minutes. But the game is done and dusted. We were getting beat 3-1. But just to get that experience at such a young age, it just set the fuel for the fire. And I was like, you know what, I'm making sure that I give this a really good go.
100%. Now, that's quality. When you are training at Livingston and you're getting that feel for the first team at such a young age, are you really feeling like you can... So in that game, did you... I know that there's some players, Leigh, that will go, I felt it was quick, or I need to get up to speed. How did you feel in that sense?
Yeah, it was like a... I think I never took it in as much obviously, when you go in the game, you want to try and make an impact. But I think I was just 16. I was just thinking, I can't believe I'm playing first team here. Obviously, the guys are almost 2 feet taller than me. And I'm trying to win headers or win 50-50s and stuff. And after I came off that, I was like, you know what? If I'm training with the first team, I'm going to try and make an impression. And I did, because a couple of the strikers actually started to dislike me because they knew I was a threat. And that's not me being big-headed. They just knew that, you know, I'm coming for their job.
What would they do? Just
I remember we had a double session. So I trained with the first team in the morning. And then the 19s were training in the afternoon, and they wanted me to do a session with them. But some of the first team strikers, or two of the first team strikers, came and trained with the 19s as well. So we're doing a possession, and you know it's like yourself, if you're doing possession and stuff, the team that's got the ball, you try and make the possession box as big as possible. So we were doing it basically across the width of the pitch. And I was standing, obviously we were keeping the ball, and I stood away, and obviously make the pitch big, so I get the cut back, obviously I've taken a touch, bring it down, I've got all your space. Done that a couple of times, and then the striker who was on another team, I'm not going to mention his name because it would embarrass him, but he came, we stopped, and he said, you need to stop cheating. And boys obviously thought I wasn't going to speak back, and I was like, nah, tell me how I'm cheating. He's like, you need to come in and help press. I was like, but my team won the ball, so I'm standing, I'm making sure I'm making the space big. And boys that he didn't like that spoke back to him. And after that, he just caned me every time. And I was like, ah, nah, fuck this. And now he works in, I'm sure there's an opticians.
Oh, really?
He works in an opticians, yeah. And he just hated me. And from that point on, I was just like, nah, this guy. And he ended up leaving Livingston and going, I think it was to Raith Rovers or something. I think Baird don't know who he is. And it was just like, even now, like when I hear his name, I'm like, I hate that guy. Just hate him.
Insecurity in it, acting like that towards you because he probably knows that himself he ain't probably at the level or doing what he should be.
That's a guy who's like, I'm sure at the time he was 20, 27, 28, and I'm 16.
Yeah, that's wild.
And I'm just like, you're supposed to help me.
Yeah.
Not berate me and put me down. But I was at that point, I was just like, nah, I'm not bothered. And I think the rest of my teammates were like if somebody shouts at him and he's got a point, like he's going to give it back, he's not going to be shying away. And I think over the course of my career, it's probably not done me as good, but I'll never be shying away from something that if I think I'm in the wrong, I'll stand up and apologise. If I don't think I'm in the wrong and I'm getting berated for it, I'll stand up and say something, because it's not the way football works. It's all about opinions, and if you're too scared to voice your opinion, you're just going to be sitting like a mouse.
No, I agree, and I think that if right is right and wrong is wrong, right?
Exactly, yeah.
You should be able to stick up for what you believe in.
Exactly, and if it turns out to be wrong, obviously, if the manager comes across and says, look, maybe I didn't think you were totally correct at this point, I'll say, look, fair enough, I'll go and apologise. But at that point, in that moment in time, I thought I was correct, so that's why I said what I said. But listen, it is what it is, and it happened at that point, and, you know, we moved on for that after that.
Yeah, and then, so you hit the ground running at Livingston, you're scoring goals. Was there much interest from other clubs? What did the next stage look like for you?
So I never scored until I played my competitive debut. So I got told, the manager got sacked with two games to go. The assistant manager got the job for the last two games. It was Ross County at home and Partick Thistle away. And he told me on the, I think it was the Friday morning, he's like, you're going to play tomorrow? And I'm like, all right. Now, me thinking I'm going to play, okay, right, you'll be on the bench, you'll come on, you get half an hour. Whatever. And then I walked in Saturday afternoon, isn't it? Obviously, team's on the board, and I've seen my name starting. I'm like, there were so many emotions going through my head, like excitement, nervous, and I was just like, you know what, just go and play your game, just do what you've been doing in training, doing what you've been doing for the 19s and reserves, and if a chance comes your way, just, you know, stick it away. And it was 18 minutes in my debut, I scored back heel.
Back heel, yeah.
Back heel, so the crosses came in, and I've kind of like just, it's behind me, and I've just like flicked it back, and wrong foot of the goal, and it's went in, and you'll see it if you ever Google a picture of me, Leigh Griffiths Livingston, the bleached blonde hair, and my smile's as wide as a Cheshire cat. Honestly, it was the best day of my life, and I can't find the goal anywhere. I don't think, they used to have Livingston TV to watch games back and stuff, but after that, it was just like, where does this go? I could never, ever find it.
Really, yeah.
I can't ever find it.
Unbelievable feeling, though.
Oh, brilliant. And Livingston's not a big club. I think there might have been about 1,500 supporters there, but for me, it felt like there were 50,000 people there. And afterwards, you just literally couldn't wipe the smile off my face. But after like after the game, it was like, great, okay, shower changed. I'm going to go and get the bus home now. Never even got a lift home. I got the bus home.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah, it was mad, man. Walking up to the centre, walking up to the like the Livingston Centre where you got the bus, and it's just like, right, I just scored on my debut.
That's unreal.
Nobody's actually going to have a clue until it goes in the back of the paper.
Yeah. That's unreal. Great feeling. Who did you go to after Livingston?
So I left Livingston in 2009 to sign for Dundee. It's another mad story, man. I got told they were coming to buy me, and then so my agent said, look, stay on the phone, and the next couple of days is going to happen. I was like, well, I've got a holiday with Ty and Appa, with my big brother. He's like, go. He's like, go, but you might need to come back early. So I'm thinking, right, okay, if I booked for a week, I might need to leave it after 4 or 5 days. Literally, land and I in Appa, but 3 years later, the phone says, you need to go on the first flight back. He's like, you need to go to Dundee. They're sitting there wanting you to get it done and dusted. I was like, I've been here less than a day. So I had to tell my big brother, I was like, look, I was like, I need to go back. I was like, I'm going to sign for Dundee, blah, blah. So I ended up signing for Dundee for about 125 grand, which was a lot of money back then. And yeah. I think that's why they ended up.
How old are you at this point, Lee?
I'm 18.
Young.
Yeah. Which, again, I think the money Dundee spent that year, I think they were third or fourth in the full of Scotland, so obviously Rangers, Celtic. Sure, Hearts it was as well, and then Dundee were the most spent clubs in Scotland, which, again, brilliant. I signed for another big club in Scotland, and yeah, I hit the ground running when I went up there as well.
That's quality. What was Dundee like as a club? Did you enjoy it there?
Loved it, absolutely loved it. The woman who was like the player liaison officer, I still speak to now, Laura Hayes. She was like a mum figure to me up there. When I went up there, I didn't know anybody. I was travelling, I was literally getting two buses in the morning to meet other teammates to get a lift up, because again, I still didn't drive. And then I ended up getting a flat up there, and it was just like, it was so much easier. I was going to training every morning, I was getting literally a few of the boys who had signed, obviously, over the summer as well. I think there were 10 signings. So all the new signings basically stayed in the same street, different blocky flats, whatever one they wanted, blah, blah, blah. So I always used to get a lift up to training and back. And it wasn't until I met my ex-partner who, when I signed up there, I've got three kids there now. I met her up there as well. So, yeah, Dundee's always a nice place.
Yeah, of course. Was there a lot of banter going on with you boys living so close to each other and with each other?
No, not really, I think. But the change, I'll never forget that change room, though. There's the couple of guys in there, Gary Harkins and Craig McEwen, the double act, them two, man. Honestly, I've never met two guys like this in my life. They're the funniest guys. They could just literally sit in a room and I could just stare at them. And the way they would talk to each other, their facial expressions, talk to other folk, I could just laugh all day. It's honestly, it's so hard to explain, but just the way they were with each other and everybody else, they're brilliant. I think a lot of people, if you ask, if they've played with Gary Harkins, Jeebs, he'll be definitely up there with the top three funniest players I've ever played with.
Really?
He had the ability as well. The ability the guy had, man, was second to none. You couldn't ever take him. He was faster with the ball at his feet than without.
Wow.
His technical ability was ridiculous. And we had such a good team that year as well, and we ended up sacking him. I'm sure we were clear at the top of the league that season. Ballpark thing. I think we were about 4 or 5 points clear at the top of the league in March. And we got to Partick Thistle away. It was one of the hardest places to go and try and get a result. And we drew 0-0. And the manager got sacked that night.
Wow.
And we were sitting top of the league. And by the end of the league, I think we ended up finishing 12 points behind.
How do they justify that? It was just...
I don't know. I think it was the owners and stuff that didn't want the manager to try to take us up. They'd bring somebody else in. And results just never went our way. But I've no doubt in my mind if we kept the manager we had, we would have won the league.
Wow.
We had already won the Scottish Challenge Cup in November against the team that were second. We were 2-0 down. We came back 1-3-2. And just after that, I think right before our roll, we went up to Inverness. We drew one each, Boxing Day. It's like, right, we're going to win this league now. We've got to Partick Thistle. We get a draw, good result, still top of the league. And we sat the manager and it's like, why? You look back now, you're thinking, why sack the manager when you're like, who are you going to ever sack a manager when you're top of league? Clear.
And a draw, not even a loss.
Exactly, yeah. You can understand, right? Okay, if we lost the game and things that he had an argument about, board, blah, blah, blah. We didn't. Played well, no. We'll take it back up to Dundee, we'll take a point on the board, still top of league, clear. So, right, manager's been. We got a phone call, I think the captain phoned us about 8 o'clock. Manager's been sacked. Meeting tomorrow morning.
Wow. At the top level, is that how it normally works when a gaffer gets sacked? Will they have a meeting in the morning and the club will talk to you, or is it just different in different clubs?
Yeah, it's different in different clubs. Like I've had a manager who's said in March that he's leaving at the end of the season. He's not renewing his contract, blah, blah, blah. Other managers just up sticks and go. So let's say it just depends. It depends where you are. But yeah, the one at Dundee, I'll always remember that one.
Yeah, when you're at Dundee, are you getting attraction from when was the whole Celtic thing? When did they come about where they were interested in you?
So I left Dundee in the January to go to Wolves. So I signed for Wolves in January.
Oh, sorry, you were at Wolves first. Yeah, sorry, I didn't mind.
So I signed for Wolves in January, and then I played, like, it was reserve football for 6 months. Done pre-season and stuff, and then they said they were going to send me out on loan. And then my agent phoned me and said, Hibs are trying to get you on loan for 6 months. And I was like, make this happen, please. I think I signed for Hibs a couple of days before the end of the transfer window, but they had the Edinburgh Derby. I had to sign on a Friday if I wanted to play the Edinburgh Derby on a Sunday. So I said, you need to get this done because my first game needs to be the Edinburgh Derby. I think it gets done on the Thursday night, it gets done. I trained Friday, trained Saturday, and playing the Edinburgh Derby. I came off the bench on the Edinburgh Derby on the Sunday.
What was that like as a Hibs fan?
I should have been sent off my first challenge.
Really?
Yeah, a rush of blood to the head. I came on, ball was off. It was a thrown on the far side of, obviously, subs we made. Ran across, refs right, like, okay, let's go. Throne's been put back to the centre-half and I've just lunged in, two-footed challenge. I'm thinking, right, okay, this is hard. I'm getting stuck in here. And the ref's like, if you went just on the pitch, I'd have sent you off. He's like, that's a shocking challenge. I was like, ref, I went for the ball. And looking back at it now, obviously, with VAR and stuff, if it goes to VAR, I'm off.
Yeah.
Like, it would have been one of the quickest sendings off you've ever seen. But, obviously, we got beat that game and I think that season was... We were fighting relegation. There was a lot of the manager who signed me got sacked, and then we bring in the Irish manager Pat Fenlon, fighting relegation and stuff. But we end up getting to the Scottish Cup final as well. It's a topsy turvy season.
Yeah.
We didn't actually officially stay up until the second last game of the season when we beat Dunfermline 4-0 at home. But then obviously we got the Scottish Cup final and against Hearts and got absolutely embarrassed.
Yeah, that's a big achievement to get to the cup final, right? Where were they at the time, Hibs? Because I know Hibs have been, they've had topsy-turvy.
Yeah, no,
time,
we're in the Premier League. Obviously, we're in the bottom six, taking against relegation, but I always knew the quality we had, we'd stay up. And just the cup run we had was brilliant. We had Cowdenbeath, we had Aberdeen, that's the next against season. We had Cowdenbeath that season, we had Kilmarnock, Area United, and then Aberdeen. So, yeah, we had a pretty easy run towards the final. You know, the Aberdeen won it in the semi-final was a good game. First time I played at Hamlin. And I scored the winner that game as well. Great occasion, and obviously get to the Scottish Cup final against your local rivals, especially Hearts. Biggest game, biggest derby that there's ever going to be, I think. And yeah, we got absolutely embarrassed.
What's that like afterwards when you get embarrassed against your biggest rivals? How do you pick yourself up as a team and individually from that?
It's hard, you know. I still get taunted for it to this day.
Do you?
Yeah. The Hearts fans still sing about it. Still sing about the game now. Hibs fans have won the Scottish Cup, and that was the whole, you know, rigmarole why Hearts were slagging Hibs, blah, blah, blah. But yeah, the game itself, horrible game, and then just like going back towards Edinburgh after, because literally Edinburgh's empty because everybody in Edinburgh's went to the game in Glasgow.
Yeah.
So we're driving back through and just the bus is so quiet. Just everybody's just not speaking to each other, just thinking, right, just let's just hurry up and get off the bus, go home. The season's finished. We'll see what happens next season. And yeah, just, yeah, it was a summer of absolute torture.
Yeah.
Especially, I think social media was just creeping into this bit as well now. So I was over social media. It wasn't as big as what it is now. But yeah, started social, if it was flipped over now, the social media, it'd be
carnage. Yeah,
horrendous.
When you were playing at that level, I want to talk to you about the social media. As a player who has taken a lot of stick from opposing fans, was in that time there, was that the time at Hibs where you made the gesture to other supporters? Was that that loan spell? Or was that?
Yeah, that was a loan spell, yeah. So I done it. I done one to the Rangers fans, which I didn't. Looking back, I'm thinking, right, okay, it's stupid, but I ended up getting a ban for it. And then the second ban I got was, we were playing Kenilworth, and we were drawing 0-0 at the time, which again for Hibs isn't a great result. But again, we were still playing well, we were still creating chances, we just couldn't score. And I ended up scoring. My frustration just took over, and I literally done the gesture again. But I was just like, fucking calm down. Do you know what I mean? I ended up getting another ban for that, and then the third ban I got that season, which you think I'd learnt my lesson. We're playing St Johnstone at home. And I'm sure, again, it was 0-0. Playing well. Just couldn't put the ball in the back of the net. And I went over to take a corner. And I've heard something saying, Griffiths, you're fucking useless. And I've literally not even looked around. I just stuck my middle finger up to him. I was like, I'm fucking having this. I'm trying to win the game for my boyhood club. I'm not fucking attempting to do anything else. And you're sitting in the stand calling me useless. You've actually paid to come in here and watch me. And you're calling me useless. Like, how's that work? So after that third one, I was like, right, this can't go on any longer. The club gave me an absolute bollocking as well.
Did the gaffer call you in?
Yeah, so obviously I got a ban from the first game, a ban for the second game. I'm not actually sure if I got a ban for the third game, but the third gesture, like the manager said, look, you can't continue to do this. He's like, if you do and you keep getting banned, you're like, you'll never play. And that's when it hit me, it hit nail on the head. I was like, right, that's it, done. Just try and have to block it out, regardless if it's home supporters, away supporters, you just need to block it out as much as you can. Just not react.
Were you able to do that? Because that must be tough. When you're playing in stadiums, Leigh, that you were playing in packed out stadiums, some of them are giving you shit. It must be hard not to just give them a little middle finger or whatever it was, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. But you've got to remember you're a professional. You need to try and conduct yourself in the best way possible. And off the pitch, I've not done that. And on the pitch, I've tried to do it as much as I can. Yeah, I was young and naive at the time. Obviously, when I go to Celtic, it was a lot more different because at Hibs, you're not expected to win every game. They expect you to win every game, the fans, but as a club, right, okay, against Rangers, Celtic, Hart, are you expected to get stuff from the game? No. Hart's game, yeah, maybe. Celtic, Rangers, maybe it's a bonus if you get something from the game. You go to Celtic, it's different ballgame altogether. You get beat or you drop points. How can you drop points against this team? Why did you drop points against this team? That's the questions you get asked every week.
And I guess when you're at Celtic and all the other teams, when they play you, it's like a cup final for them, right?
Absolutely, yeah. Especially when they come to Celtic Park, it's like a free hit for them. So they come in, they'll sit and defend, try and hit us on a counter-attack. And if they get something from the game, it's like they've won the World Cup. For us, it's horrendous. And I remember watching, listening to games from the touchline or being on the pitch. Also, we could be winning or drawing 0-0, 80-odd% possession of the ball. Again, possession doesn't win you the game, but you know, we're playing well, we're moving the ball, we just can't put the ball in the back of the net. It's still 15, 20 minutes to go. And the fans are booing us if we make a backward pass. And it's like we're drawing 0-0, we're trying to tire the other team out, trying to create opportunity, and you are still booing us. Now, don't get me wrong, the Celtic fans are the best I've ever experienced in my life, but the flip side of that is they can get on top of you very, very quickly.
Does that make it tougher? You know, when you're 0-0 and you're trying to win the game, you're trying to, like you say, tire the other team out. You know what you're doing, you boys. Obviously, knocking the ball about, keeping possession. How hard is it to switch off from them booing you, passing backwards?
I see the minute you score. That's it. Done. Do you know what I mean? It's a weird one, but we're trying to... It's like the fans are getting frustrated that, obviously, we're trying to keep the ball, but obviously the message we've got from the manager during training is... keep the ball, tire out, because at some stage, one of the players is going to go, you know what, fuck this, I'm going to try and win the ball. And that's when you go pop, pop, pop. You get the chance, and that's when you score. and the amount of late winners we scored in the Brendan Rodgers in his first season, that was when it first came about. He wanted to keep the ball and play and tie the other team out. The amount of late winners we scored that season was madness.
When you were at Hibs on that loan spell, and then you went back to Wolves, and you were playing in the Premier League, what was playing in the Premier League like?
I never played in the Premier League.
Was it Championship you played?
League One.
Was it League One?
League One, yeah.
Okay.
It was crazy because Hibs had the chance to buy me in the January. I think it was for £50,000 or something, which is not a lot of money.
Yeah.
I think Wolves just said, look, if you just want to buy him, you can have him. No, I think I was on 16 goals at the time for Hibs. And Hibs were thinking, right, okay, they want 50 grand. But in the summer, they'll just let him go for free.
Yeah.
So we'll just take him. Like, he'll come and sign for us, not a problem. And I would have, if that was the case. If Wolves released me, I would have signed for Hibs straight away. But I ended up scoring 28 goals that season. I got Young Player of the Year in Scotland that year. I should have won the double. For the life of me, I don't know why Michael Higdon won it. He was playing well, but, you know, 28 goals in a team that were struggling again at the bottom of the league. Got to another Scottish Cup final, so we got to two Scottish Cup finals in a row. Thought I was playing the best football I could at that time. Doing well, and then I was in the summer, I got a phone call for Kenny Jackett. Kenny Jackett just got the job at Wolves. You know, his London accent is mad. He's like, Leigh, how you doing? Yeah, I'm no bad. Kenny Jackett, yeah. that's a terrible sort of London accent.
That's decent, mate.
So anyway, I spoke, and he's like, look, he's like, I've seen what you've done last season. He's like, I want you to come down here. I want you to come back, be in my team. Going to give you a number 9 shirt as well, which is massive for me. Always wanted to be a number 9. And from that point, I was like, right, okay, let's like have pre-season. They had pre-season in Scotland as well, so it helped. I was seeing my family stuff. But yeah, after that, it's like, right, okay, go down and, you know, let's see where we can go. And the team we had at the time at Wolves is, we still have boys playing from the Premier League days. So obviously going in that changing room with guys like Kevin Doyle, Jamie O'Hara, Bakary Saka. Saka. Guys like this, it's just like we've got a really good chance of winning the league here. And we started off really well, Preston away. First time I'd seen a sold out away crowd. I think it was like 3,500 Wolves fans made the trip up to Preston. No. And then after that, we played really well. A lot of good games, a lot of good goals. And thinking, right, okay, let's see where this season takes us. And it was in started December time. My agent phoned me at the time and he's like, look, Celtic are interested in you. Would you go there in January? I was like, I'll run up the road to go to Celtic. Being from Scotland, you know how big Celtic are.
Yeah.
And he's like, right, okay. He's like, let's leave it. Leave it just now. He's like, I'll be in touch if they're going to make any bids. So I think Celtic made 2 bids in January. Both got rejected. And then Tam, my agent at the time, said, they're going to make 1 more bid. He's like, but you need to go in and make sure it happens, because I don't think they're going to accept it. But if you go in and say, look, heart set and going to Celtic, I want to go back up the road to you, 2 young kids at the time, would you let me go? So I ended up not going in to the chief executive's office. I was still young at the time, and I was like, I didn't want to go in and cause any drama. So I was like, you know what? My agent said, he phoned me the day before the end of the transfer window. He's like, right, pack your stuff in your house, put it in the car, and head up. He's like, I'll book you a hotel in Penrith. So it's like halfway between Wolverhampton and Scotland. He's like, the Jez Mockley's going to phone you at 6 o'clock tomorrow morning. Obviously, it's the transfer window day, that everybody wants to get things done early. He's like, I don't know what he's going to say. He's like, but if it doesn't let you go, you've got stuff in the car, you just take it back down the road. If it lets you go, you're 2 hours away from Scotland. He's like, I'll drive up, I'll stay in Manchester, I'll drive up in the morning, I'll meet you. So, right, okay. So I get up to Penrith, get to the hotel, lie in my bed, and I'm thinking, do I even try and sleep here? Because if I miss this phone call in the morning and saying, either you're going or you're not, like, this could, like, make or break my career. Because at the time I was thinking, right, I just want to go to Celtic now. Like, I enjoyed Wolves, but when the chance to come to Celtic comes, like, it doesn't come around often, so you want to take it with both hands. So I think he phoned me at like 14 minutes past six. So I'm looking at my, I've got my phone waiting at 6 o'clock. I was like six oh one two. I was like, this cunt's not phoning me. He's not letting me go. And he was like quarter past six, 14 minutes past six. He phones me. He's like, Lee, Jez, Mark's loud. And I was like, yeah, I'm good, Jez. How are you? Blah, blah. He's like, right. He's like, two conditions. One, I'm going to let you go, but you need to forego any bonuses you have if we win the league. So we were sitting top of the league at the point at the stage, and I'm not actually sure how much I ended up. I've got. I might have been 60, 70 grand or something if we won the league. You need to give that up if you're going to Celtic. No problem. Done deal. He's like, right, okay. I wish you and your family all the best. And I said, right, Jez, thanks very much. Blah, blah. Literally, showered, changed, straight up to Celtic Park. Honestly, the smile on my face that day, when my mum was like, Mum, I'm coming home. She's like, what do you mean you're coming home? I was like, I'm signing for Celtic today. I'm going up, doing my medical and stuff now. She's like, you're kidding on. I was like, no, I was like, serious, I'm coming back, blah, blah, blah. It wasn't until I got to Celtic Park and she turned on the TV and Sky Sports News, see me transfer deadline day and walking about Celtic Park. Hairline starting at the back of my ankles a lot, man. Jumping on. I got to Celtic Park about 8:30. And I ended up leaving about 10 to 12 midnight. 10 to midnight.
Really?
That's how long it took, yeah. So medicals, but fitness test, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, it was one of the days it just took forever, but I'm just glad it got done at the end.
Yeah, massive. Obviously, being from Scotland as well, I'm from England, and I know how big a club Celtic is. I'm glad you cleared that up about Wolves as well, because I remember really well. I think I told you last night, watching you for Wolves on Sky Sports, there was one game I remember quite clearly watching you. You scored a penalty real late on Sky
Sports. That was a Crawley Town game, yeah. Friday night?
Yeah.
So I was on the bench at a game because Kenny, when I first went back down to Wales, Kenny said, look, every 6 weeks, we'll give you 4 days off so you can go back up to Scotland, but make sure you come back down on the Thursday to train Thursday, train Friday. You'll be in the bench Saturday, but you'll come on and play. Obviously, we trained at this game we had, obviously, on a Friday night. So Kenny said, look, same thing, just come down, train Thursday, bench Friday, but you'll come on. Blah, blah. And it wasn't until that game that I came on, scored a penalty. I shanked the penalty as well, but it was shocking.
The goalie should have saved it, really.
But anyway, I've had about 3 or 4 penalties like that in my career that I've had it. I tried to hit it down the middle as hard as I can, and I just shank it, and somehow the goalie just dives over the top of the ball. I'm like, oh.
It's weird that I remember that particular penalty, and that I've gone on to meet you later on years of life. I remember you they did an interview with you after, you were like, there was no way I was missing that penalty. I was going, I don't know that.
No, again, interviews and stuff. You need to try and obviously be as confident as you can.
Yeah.
But yeah, obviously when you hit the ball as hard as you can, you just want the net to ripple, see the fans go mad behind you, and it's not until afterwards you actually look at the replay and think, fucking hell, that was close, man. The goal was fucking very, very close to saving that.
Hey, as long as it goes in, mate.
That's it.
When you've arrived at Celtic, did you feel that immediate pressure that you're now at Celtic, you need to win every game? Because obviously going from, I know Wolves were top, and I just learnt there that you were League One, so Wolves in League One is a giant club. How did you deal with the pressure early on? Are you someone that deals with pressure well, or?
Yeah, so obviously I think it wasn't until my competitive debut against, so I never got registered in time to play on the Saturday. I think they were trying to get me registered in time, but the SFA didn't allow it. And the game on a Saturday, I'm sure it was St Mirren at home, introduced at half-time, blah, blah, blah. And the next game week, we had Aberdeen in the Scottish Cup at home, live on TV. We got put out that game, we got beat 2-1. We actually went 1-0 up, and we got put out. And afterwards, obviously, Celtic, you shouldn't be getting put out at home, especially in the home in a cup. But afterwards, I was thinking, this is massive, man. Like, if you can't get beat at home in a cup game, it's like, it doesn't happen. And it wasn't until after that. Obviously, social media is getting bigger and bigger now. And I think, obviously, the pressure you've got, fans are tweeting you, blah, blah. Obviously, I'm just new. I only, just made an impact. But even fans were saying, why have we signed this guy? I played 25 minutes, mate. What do you want me to expect? What do you expect me to do in 25 minutes? I've done everything I can. So after that, I was like, right, okay, the pressure is massively on you. And at the time, Rangers weren't in the league. So it's like, basically a foregone conclusion. It was like, right, okay, how many points are we going to win by? But yeah, after that, I think it was two or three weeks later, I scored my first goal for Celtic, away at Hearts.
Oh, was it away at Hearts as Hearts. Well?
Yeah, you couldn't write it, man.
I bet you enjoyed that one.
You could not write it. Second half, ball, big long ball's been played up, and I just got my body in front of the defender, but running through, he's managed to get back in front of me. So I've kind of like turned my body, shielded it, and then I swivel back and smashed the bottom corner. And I've just seen, like, literally, I've just seen mist and just went straight for the Hearts fans and just slid in front of them. And then after that, I've just done a massive loop past all the Celtic. I didn't even thank the Celtic fans, which is stupid of me. Massive loop and went to the manager. We ended up winning the game 2-0. And after that, I was just like, wow, what a feeling that was. I think I scored the hat trick two games later at home.
Unreal.
Yeah. And after that, I was just like, right, wow, I'm ready to kick on.
Yeah, once you've hit that, you're ready to just kick on then. Was there any backlash on the back of sliding in front of the Hearts fans?
Yeah, there's a lot of memes, to be fair. because I've slid on my knees and I've had this with my hands. And there was a woman who, she looked a bit heavy. So obviously there's a lot of pictures and there's me like this. And there's a big massive hot dog in my hand. Because I'm basically just sliding in front of her.
Oh, which, really?
Looking back, it's always horrible if the women's ever saw it to look back. But I remember that game as well because we were playing, when we Celtic warm up, you warmed up the far side, right next to the Hearts fans, and we're there, obviously, more mad supporters go. And I remember seeing my two Hearts fans' cousins, were in the stand. And it wasn't until I slid on my knees and I stood up and I was looking and I just seen them giving me dogs abuse.
Were they giving you it? Yeah.
Oh, stinking. Dogs abuse. And I was just like, right, okay, I've made it now. Especially when your family members are giving you dogs abuse. That's the best part, man.
Yeah, that's quality.
I'm real.
That's quality. Seeing your two cousins and giving you dogs. Brilliant. When you were playing, obviously you've had moments like that where you've gestured to the fans. Are you a player that would go, if the away fans are on you, you use that as fuel, you like that?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Because they know, the minute any fans give you abuse, and it's happened even here, the minute any fans give you abuse, see the minute you score, they shut up. And that's what my dad's always said, is that anybody's giving you any abuse, is that the minute you score, you'll hear nothing after that. That's it. And it happened to Hearts, giving dogs abuse, blah, blah. You score, nothing. And it's nuts to think about that. You could score, obviously, they could be singing about you before the game, blah, blah. You score in the first minute for the next eight to nine, you don't hear nothing.
Yeah.
Absolutely nothing.
The only way to shut them up is to score
goals. That's it.
And you've got a good habit of scoring goals.
I wish you said that yesterday. Shocking.
Are you still spewing off of that? Yeah?
He looked like he was got to batter me again, man, this morning, after he just before he left. But no, the best way to shut other fans up is just to score goals.
Of course. Rangers, Celtic games, what are they like to play in?
So my first Rangers Celtic game was at Hampden. We got them in a Scottish Cup semi-final when Rangers were in the Championship at the time. This is my first full season. And we got them in the February time. We got drawn against them in December. I played them against them in February. And just the build up to that, man, it's like nothing you've ever experienced in your life. The week is built up to the Sunday. Every single day, it's getting worse and worse. And then obviously you go to the hotel the night before the game. You come out in the morning and there's fans waiting for you at the hotel to see you off to go to the game. Nuts.
That's different level,
yeah,
there, isn't it?
I'm talking like, it's not just a couple of fans. I'm talking like 300-400 fans outside the hotel, just ready to send you to go to a game. And then as you're driving to Hampden, Celtic and Rangers have got different ends. So Rangers are coming one end, Celtic are going another. So one side's green, the other side's blue.
Yeah.
Just the streets. So obviously you got a police escort that day along the motorway. It's not about a 10, it's about a 15-minute drive from the hotel to the stadium. And the minute you come off the motorway, you come off the motorway and you turn left to go up to Hampden, green everywhere. Fans clapping you, waving scarves, blah, blah. I'm like, what the fuck is going on here, man? This is nuts. Obviously, you get in the Hampden, you go underground at Hampden, you walk in the changing room, you get changed, blah, 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 you're ready for a warm-up, you walk out, and you look at either here, boo, or fans clapping you like mad. And there's Hampden holds 50,000 folk. It must have been three quarters full by the time we're in the warm-up, between both sets of fans.
Astonishing.
Mad. Can't hear yourself talk, can't hear yourself think. Game starts, both fans gone mad. That's the first time they played each other in, what is it, 3 years? So
that game in particular would have been electric.
Yeah, so obviously Rangers fans thinking, right, we've got a chance to turn them over here. Celtic fans, obviously Celtic fans, the media and stuff, it's basically how many is Celtic going to win by. Pitch was shocking. I've seen better pitches in public parks here. Pitch was shocking at the time. I think after 15 minutes I've scored header, back post. Ball's been zung at the back post and I've jumped up, headed it past him. I've literally just turned away. Anthony Stokes tries to grab me, one of the biggest Celtic fans you'll meet. He's tried to grab me. I said, get the fuck off me now, man. Literally just jumped up in front of the Rangers fan and just went. And after that, I'm thinking, wow. Like, I should have turned and looked at Celtic fans. Obviously, Celtic, but if you've ever seen games at Hampden, you see the split. Half green, half blue. Yeah. I should have just turned around and just watched them all celebrate. But nah, brilliant. Great header. Obviously, people saying the defender's got to do better. But for me, I've just jumped up and headed the back stick. I'm thinking, brilliant goal.
Happy days, yeah.
We end up going in 2-0. Game's comfortable. Win the game 2-0. It was a League Cup semi-final. It wasn't a Scottish Cup semi-final. It was a League Cup semi-final. We end up winning the cup match. Beat Dundee United in the final. That was my first trophy. The second trophy we got. I won the league last year with Celtic, but I didn't really contribute to that. Contributed to the second part of the second season, winning the league and stuff. Second full season. That's when I scored 40. That season,
outrageous. That
everything I touched went in. I missed a month of injury as well that season, so, and wow. Missed four penalties.
Really? And you banged in 40?
Banged in 40,
outrageous, yeah. Man. Leigh, when you've scored that goal against Rangers, again, it makes it bigger that they haven't played each other for 3 years. When you're stood there like that, yeah, and you're seeing the rage, are you inside just like buzzing?
Like, absolutely. It's weird. Like, you're buzzing, you're jumping. Obviously, your stomach's doing backflips, but you're just looking at people, but you're getting abuse. But you're only getting abused for 2-3 seconds before the rest says, right, before you start, all right, let's move, let's get started again. So I scored in an Old Firm. My only regret is I never scored an Old Firm goal at Celtic Park. Scored two at Ibrox, one at Hampden, and never scored at Celtic Park.
Right.
And I was there at one glorious chance against Rangers, and it took a bobble, literally the slightest bobble. I was able to smash it past the goalie. Took a slight bobble and just went clean over the bar. The game is done, but I'm thinking, like, that was my only regret at Celtic, because I've forgot a lot of regrets, but on a pitch, not scoring against Rangers at Celtic Park.
You talk about regrets in your career and stuff. Do you think, I did a little bit of research online, of course, prior to this interview. Spoke to Birdie doesn't say anything but good things about you. I actually loved last night. I want to thank you, by the way, for letting us come to your missus' party last night. It was brilliant. We had a really, really good time. I think the one of the best things for me, you know, obviously I don't know you, I met you for the first time yesterday, was it was great to see you last night. You're like a normal family man. You're with your daughters, you know, looking after your missus. Do you think at times, because I'll read things up, that when I've done research, do you think the media have been hard on you at times, or just made a story out of you?
They've made a story because I've gave them a story by being stupid in the past, and now, obviously, I don't know what research I've done and how far you've went back. If you went back the full way when I started, basically at Hibs, it'd be a long fucking read. And it's probably not something to laugh about. Obviously, there's been stuff that I've done that's definitely hindered my career a bit, and stages as such. And I think if I could go back, relive my whole life again, but not relive my whole life again, but if I could go back to my start of my Hibs career and say, right, you're going to have your full career, same kind of career you've had, but every mistake you can rectify. I don't want to blow my own trumpet, but I'd probably would have scored over 200 goals for Celtic. Looking back over Hibs, Wolves, Celtic, chances, everything that I've done, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, if I screwed the head on properly, I would have easily scored over 200 goals for Celtic.
What do you think it was that sort of off the pitch, you know, those certain antics, what was it? Was it in the moment? Because I guess as well, Leigh, right, this is me, I've only ever played at sort of semi-pro level, but when you're a young lad, you're doing well, you're smashing goals in, you get a big move, everything you do is under the spotlight. So I can sit here, Leigh, and tell you now that when I was 18, 19, 20, 21, I made mistakes. But guess what? People don't know about them because I wasn't a high-profile footballer. So everyone makes those mistakes. When it's highlighted, it obviously makes it more difficult, right?
Yeah, especially when you go to Celtic as well. Hibs was like bad. I've done a lot of mistakes on the Hibs. But it's not when you go to Celtic that you've got basically the full of Scotland media wise on your case. You couldn't go for a Nelson Riddle with it. If somebody wanted to take a picture in your toilet, it'd go straight in the paper. Like, that's how bad it got. And it got to the point for me, like, it's like, do you actually want to go outside? It's like, it got to the point where, like, can I go to Asda? Or can I go to go for food without, like, going anywhere? Like I said, I could go for a beer outside with my mates, and somebody will take a picture, put it online, and that picture will go on the papers. Leigh Griffiths out having drinks. I'm thinking, how the fuck is that even a story?
So what? You're a human being.
Exactly. And I got to the point that some of the stories that were going in the paper, and me, I'm fickle. I used to read comments online what they were saying, blah blah blah. And it got to the point where people are writing on Instagram, how the fuck is this making headlines? Like, what is the point? Like, you've got people that are, like, murdering folk, blah, blah. And this guy's, again, he's out having a beer, or he's doing something, like, that's not even newsworthy. And you're sticking in the paper. For what? Why?
And even the fact that you can't go out without someone taking a picture, that's annoying. You're a footballer. You're a talent at the highest level. But you still deserve to go and have a meal with your mates and a few beers.
Even like after, like me and my missus after games at Celtic, do you want to go for food? I'm thinking, now 9 times out of 10, if that's like anybody else, I will go for food. Would you want to go? We'll pick somewhere, we'll go out, have a nice meal, a couple of drinks, go home. Like we could go out for a meal, for argument's sake, 7:30. We'd be back in the house by 9 o'clock. Because she's worried. I'm getting worried that we're getting pictured out having a Chinese meal after a game. Leigh Griffiths out for Chinese meal. Like, that's the kind of stuff that would go in the paper. And I'm not making excuses for why my career's went downhill, but I'm just saying, like, this is the stuff that people didn't see. Or is out enjoying himself. Like, he had a Chinese meal after a game. And what? Are you going to take a picture of the rest of the 50 folk that's in the restaurant? Just because they're not famous, they have an exact same meal as me, but because I'm famous, I guess they make the paper. Why?
You just want to be left alone as well. Yeah.
And that, I got to the point where she used to ask, you want to go for food? I was like, nah. I don't want to go out.
I don't
even,
blame
even
you.
Even when the kids used to come and stay, I didn't used to hate it because I love my kids are my life. But it was like, trying to take them out or try and do something fun with them became very, very, very hard. Because people just either want to give you abuse when you're out with the kids, which is, in my opinion, disgusting. If my kids, obviously whoever they support, if they see their rival player, and decide to give him abuse when he's out with his kids, not on for me.
Nah, no chance.
On a football pitch, I'll take it, not a problem. Off the pitch when I'm with my kids, different ballgame.
Have you experienced that when you're with your kids?
Yeah.
That's mental to me. That's crazy.
Like, especially like when I'm out, people walk past me or they shout something. Like, I've got one of my kids has got like cerebral palsy, my old case is cerebral palsy, but he's very switched on in the brain. So if somebody's walking past me and they'll shout something to me, like, Dad, why is that man just called you that? And I'm like, ah, just keep walking. Let's go.
You shouldn't have to deal
no,
with
it. No, and that's like, but see, if I was to turn on the telly, I'm the one that gets in trouble.
Yeah.
And it happened, I was, there's a couple of incidents back in Scotland that's happened, and I've retaliated. And I was like, I'm the one that gets in trouble. Nobody's going to mourn this guy for giving me dogs abuse.
Because he doesn't but make
I'm the
story.
One, but I'm the one that makes the headlines because I've attacked another human being. No, I'm not attacked. I've been provoked. I'm standing with my kids waiting to do something, and they feel that they've got the right to come up and give me dogs abuse. It wouldn't happen to anybody else in the street. So why is it okay for somebody to come and do it to me?
You get a normal dad up the road, and he's with his kids, and someone does something in front of the kids. He's going to react. Yeah. He's going to do something. It's just because you're Leigh Griffiths.
Nobody, you can't do anything.
I don't like that, you see. And I'm all for it. I'm a football fan. I grew up on the terraces at Cambridge United. Give dogs abuse to players. Accept it in the small little world that I play in football. Take dogs abuse. But when you're out with your kids, mate, come on. Like, you've got to be better than that, haven't you?
But that's what I mean. Like, obviously, you've experienced it. Like you say, you've been Cambridge fans. So whoever their rivals are, if you've seen one of their rival players out, you're not going to stand and give him dogs abuse in the middle of the street, regardless if he's with his kids or not.
Wouldn't bother me, because it's not at football.
No, but that's what I mean. Like, that's the world that we live in now. Like, everything is done for social media. So, see, if I was to walk past somebody and say something, no doubt somebody would be filming somewhere just to get the reaction to put it online and say, by the way, this is what Leigh Griffiths done. And if it happened in Scotland, it's in the paper within the next hour. Online the next hour.
That's so intrusive in your private life. I'm big on, you know, footballers should have their life. I dreamt of being a footballer, Lee. And growing up, I always used to think I'd love that in the stadium, everyone knowing who you are, everyone chanting your name. The minute that I was out that stadium, I've always been that. I always had that thought. I'd wish no one would know me.
Yeah, and that's it's weird, but this is why I love living here. Because obviously Mandra, scoring goals, blah, 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 people know who you are. See, you walk down, or you go to the shopping centre, 10 minutes down the road, nobody has a clue who you are. You walk up, I mean that I've walked about shopping centres back in Edinburgh, and it'd take you, anything that would take you normally 10 minutes to do, it could take you 45 minutes to an hour. People stop you, you want to have chats, blah, blah, blah. Here, you get it done rapidly. They don't care. I could go out for a beer, like, Sunday. You couldn't go out for a beer without getting pictured, blah, 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 back home. Here, you could go out and get absolutely smashed out of your face. Nobody bats an eyelid. And that's another thing that JB says, you come over here, you actually have a life.
Yeah.
And I think that's what my two daughters last night, where it was hard for me to do anything back home with them. I'd done stuff, but it was hard. It was hard to do, like, keep them occupied and entertained and stuff. Over here, it's like, right, okay, what do you want to go and do? Do you want to go swimming? Right, okay, we'll go swimming. Do you want to go to the zoo? Not a problem. Walk about the zoo and nobody bats an eyelid. You go just do everything you want. And they don't care.
That's important for you as a human, forgetting
that you're not just for, it's yeah. not even for me anymore, because I've learned to deal with, if I'm getting abuse, I'll take it.
Yeah.
But for them to come over and see a different side of their dad, then two other kids came over three weeks before, I think they seen a different side to me as well. Like, my dad's actually like smiling, we actually go and do stuff over here and nobody like annoys him. And I think for them it's just like, I don't think they'll realise it until they go back home. Obviously they go back home Tuesday. They'll go back home Wednesday, probably Thursday, Friday, and realise like, wow, like, dad's actually enjoying his life over there. Like, we had so much fun back in Glasgow. Like, did we have fun? Probably not as much as what we should have, but over in Australia, I get the other side of the world, but like, we still done everything we wanted to do, and like, we had smiles on our faces. Dad had a smile on his face. Caitlin had a smile on her face. Like, everybody was smiling around. There was nobody cutting about, like, arguing or wanting to cause fights or that. It was just everything just plain sailing.
Is that the main reason you made the choice to move here?
No, it was one of the reasons, but obviously the fact that I experienced it back in August, what the life could be like. Obviously, knowing the club, I've only known JB less than, texting for just over a year, which is mad to think.
Yeah.
But when I came over in August, came over for 3 weeks, and it was, It was probably the best 3 weeks I've had in my life.
Really?
A different experience, obviously. The furthest I've travelled in the world, this side would be Dubai. Obviously, I've been to America and stuff, but this side, coming over, would be Dubai. So it's like, right, okay, you get to Dubai, you've got another 12 hours to go. You land in Australia, and obviously, Javi meets me at the airport, you come. Again, it's no Celtic Park, but now, this is where I call home. This stadium, like, obviously, we're doing it at, and it's like, I don't care. I've played in front of 60,000, and I'm telling you now, I'm just as happy playing here and what I was there.
Are you really? Yeah.
Yeah.
That's quality.
And the boys in the change room, I've got a lot of good friends in football still, but the boys in the change room, I've never met a team who's so close unity-wise and who stays in such a close proximity. We all stay with, apart from two of the guys, one stays in Burnbury, one stays in Scarborough, but apart from that, I think the rest of the boys stay within 30 kilometres of each other, which is mad to think.
Yeah.
So close together, and obviously we've had done a really good season, but we can make it an even better season if we go and win the next three games, which it's going to be tough, but no doubt if we turn up and play our football the way we can go win the league, not a problem.
That'd be really good to see you win the league. John Bird, obviously, he said that we weren't allowed to slag him, so we won't slag him, but what a guy.
I don't actually think I could slag him.
Nah. Great guy, eh?
He is. The guy's got a heart of gold. I actually think I'm like my big brother, which is weird to say because he's my manager as well. But he's one of these guys that, I don't know if you've got big brothers, but for me, I thought my big brother, I used to be able to go and talk to him about anything. He's the exact same. He's your manager off the pitch when you come to training. He's a player when you play with him. But off the pitch, he's a friend. And that's... I can't speak highly enough of the guy. And his drinking ability is ridiculous. His drinking ability is something... I've only ever seen it from one other player in my life. Scott Brown.
Scott Brown could drink, yeah?
Oh, I'd put them both in a room and go tell them to go beer for beer, and I'm struggling to pick a winner.
Really, yeah?
Struggling to pick a winner. Both of them are ridiculous, man.
I'm glad you said that, because I'd literally have a sip last night out of my beer, and Birdie's already bringing me another one. I'm Birdie, I can't, mate.
He's relentless. Like, I've never seen a guy who could drink on a Saturday night, like you've seen him last night.
Yeah.
He'd be got up, do this podcast, and now he'll go again. Just crack on again.
Yeah, he said he's buzzing, go for a beer and a bit of food.
Sunday's his favourite day of the week.
Yeah, that's what he said to me.
Sunday's his favourite day of the week. It's insane. Doesn't matter if he win on a Saturday, draw or lose on a Saturday. A Sunday is his day. He'll get up, he could go watch the kids in the morning. If the kids are playing here, he's got keys. He can open the bar and just start cracking on himself. Like, I've seen him. I've got a picture. I'm not going to show, but I've got a picture on my phone of him on a Sunday night. We're literally through the other room, and he's lying sleeping. His missus sticking stuff in his mouth and everything. He wakes up about half an hour later. We show him pictures. He's like, that's not fucking me. I never like that. Literally, we took that half an hour ago, mate. Literally, half an hour.
What do you do? Wake up and crack open another one, eh?
Yeah, he would go insane. For half an hour power nap, and that'd be him.
I couldn't believe it last night. I was like, Birdie, I need to slow down, mate. I can't keep up, literally.
Madness, man.
What was Brendan Rodgers like to play for?
His man management skills is... Boys still talk about it now. Like James Forrest mentioned it in his testimonial thing the other day about his man management skills. And you could go and just walk up to his office thinking you're the worst player in the world. Go and have a chat with him 10, 15 minutes. He'll come out thinking you're in the same league as Messi.
Really?
That's how good he was. And I had just signed a new contract. And then I signed the contract in January, scored 40. The manager leaves and Brendan comes in. So I think in pre-season we went like an hour walk, just talking about stuff. Obviously, last year, a lot of pressure on you. We're going to bring another striker in to help you with the workload. It's like you're going to play a massive part. And I did, to be fair. I started really well that season. Champions League qualifiers, I was the one that got the nod. Played well in the league. And then end of August, start of September. So the Champions League draw has just been made. So we've been drawing a group against Man City, Barcelona, and Borussia Mönchengladbach. So that's done. Monday comes, we've got Rangers on a Saturday, coming up, and Barcelona on the Tuesday away. So I'm thinking, not wow. a bit. The next 8 days is going to be fucking incredible. On the Saturday. So we had Monday, trained Monday, Tuesday, off the Wednesday, trained the Thursday, and I got injured on the Thursday.
No.
Yeah, I pulled my calf on a Thursday. So just doing a normal drill, a normal crossing and finishing drill, going down one side, fine, crossed over, down the other side, and I just felt something, I was like, something shot my calf. I was like, what the fuck is that? I've never had a problem with my calf in my life. I was like, oh, wow. Obviously, go and see the physio, blah, blah, blah. So, look, well, life's set, we'll see where you are tomorrow. Comes in for you, still a bit sore, didn't train. So what they said they're going to do, they're going to give my fitness test Saturday morning. Obviously, because I've been playing well, scoring goals, they're going to say, right, fitness test in the morning. Right, okay, no problem. So I think, right, okay, go to a hotel, get a good night's sleep, wake up the morning, and goes, they're going to take me to Celtic Park at 7:30. I'll leave the hotel at 7:30 to go to Celtic Park at 8:00. I cut my room at 8:15. Listen, before about it, spoke to the manager. Manager's no one to risk you. I'm going to leave you, I'm going to send you for a scan on Monday. We'll leave it over the weekend, we'll send you for a scan on Monday, see what the damage is. My whole world's just been shattered. Like, you told me I'm going to have a fitness test to play against Rangers and then be ready for Barcelona away on a Tuesday night. And now I'm not going to play either. And that's the game Moussa Dembele scores a hat-trick.
Who did?
Moussa Dembele. He scores a hat-trick against Rangers. So it's Steven Gerrard's first game. I'm sure it was Steven.
I remember that.
Was it Gerrard's first? No, it wasn't Gerrard's first game. I take that back.
Moussa Dembele hat-trick.
Yeah, he scored a hat-trick, yeah. It wasn't going to play. I was playing the game. And he scores a hat-trick. I'm sure it was a perfect hat-trick as well. No, yeah, perfect hat-trick as well.
Was it perfect?
Scored a header one. Header, first goal. Outside of the foot, the right goal, second, and he scored to his left in the second half. Perfect hat trick.
Wow.
And I was buzzing for him because I seen how hard they worked, and he was still young at the time. He was 19, 20 at the time. And he come up and he was getting frustrated with himself and obviously gets that chance and scores a hat trick. But it's not now until you look, you're thinking. After that, his career just skyrocketed after that.
That's why I remember it, because when he did that, there was like so much hype around him, wasn't there? Instantly.
So it wasn't until he scored the second goal, and the commentator, it was like famous for a while. He scored the second, and the commentator said, "No Leigh Griffiths, no problems," because Moussa Dembele stepped forward. I was like, "You cheeky bastard! You cheeky bastard!" And then afterwards, my mate, who's this guy who does the Sky reporting, afterwards he said, to Brendan, it was like, Leigh Griffiths who? And Brendan was like, oh, don't be disrespectful. Now, Brendan didn't know that Luke, me and Luke know each other.
Oh,
and I was
really?
Obviously, somebody said, Luke Shanley's just done you on Sky Sports. They sent me it. And I phoned him, I was like, don't ever do that again.
You called your mate?
Aye, the mate who's doing the reporting.
Yeah.
So he said that to Brendan Rodgers, saying Leigh Griffiths who? And I was like, mate, don't ever do that again, man.
Wait, was he trying to get like a nibble off you?
No, he was trying to get a nibble off Brendan Rodgers, yeah. But Brendan just shut it down. He was like, oh, right. Don't be disrespectful.
Don't be disrespectful, yeah.
But after that, yeah.
Moussa, I vaguely remember that, you know, something along those lines, yeah.
But after that, Moussa just went on a different level, man.
Yeah.
And it was, like, the more games he played, the better he became. Machine.
Really, yeah. Yeah. And worked hard for it, you said then, yeah?
He did, yeah. And it's weird because you never really seen him in the gym.
Really?
Nah, never really seen him in the gym. But I remember one training session, I was like four teams, kind of like a round robin, two pitches. And to start the game, it was like a manager like kicked the ball up in the air, and I just ran and tried to jump, and he stood still, and I was winded for about 5 minutes. I couldn't move. I ran into him, and I was winded for about 5 minutes. It was solid.
Solid.
I was like, fuck, you know. I'm like a defender playing against you, but. Honestly.
What was Scott Brown like?
I'm trying to find Brennan one word. Nutcase. Two different guys. Two different people. Two different guys, but the same guy, if that makes sense.
Yeah, yeah.
A bit like JB. So in the change room, laughing and joking and stuff. See when you get him on a pitch, it's like something flicks in his mind. Game mode. Now, I spoke to him about this because Bruni's always got the thing about the hard man, and he is, to be fair. But you see him before a game, he just looks straight dead eye, straight down the tunnel or wherever we're walking. Nobody can get his attention. Doesn't matter who it is. Like his wife could walk past with his kids and he would blank them. Now, I asked him about it as well, and I was like, will anybody ever like make you laugh or joke on the turn? He was like, never. I was like, how do you focus that? I was like, how do you? He's like, I don't know. He's like, as soon as I walk out of the changing room, he's like, that's me. He's like, I'm focused. Like, it doesn't. And he's like, he's been best mates with a player called Kevin Thompson.
Yeah.
Since they were 16, 17. They've played against each other. And Tomo used to try and say, like, Bruno on the pitch. Like, not even try and win them, but just have a normal...
Yes, yeah.
Obviously, the ball was out for play. He's like, oh, like, what are you up to tonight? Blah, blah, blah. Bruno was like, just ignore him. Like, just ignore... I just ignored him. Bruno just ignored me. I didn't even say a word. I'm like, how is that possible? But off the pitch, wow. Biggest nudge you'll ever meet. Rave tunes, like, dance tunes, like, 90s, that's his game.
Yeah,
there's one of the games we played. He's done an interview towards his end of Celtic career, and one of the songs was on in the background just before he's done an interview, before they went on live, and he's fuck me, will you get Scooter on, will you? It's what he said. Put Scooter on.
Did he really?
I think if you go on YouTube and type in Scott Brown Scooter, and it comes up the interview. And
yeah, we'll have a look.
Fuck me, put Scooter on, will you? But yeah, I've seen him, like, obviously I've. When I passed my driving test, I've had to go and pick him up at times, and I've seen him, like, in bad, bad ways. But it's like, coffee and a look, is it? Sorted. And he was still outrunning and training. Like, this guy could be hungover to death, and he was still outrunning and training, still outworking as well. His ethic was ridiculous.
You
and
know,
that's why.
There, I can't get that, Leigh. Like, if I've had a few too many beers, I ain't moving.
No. I don't understand how people do it. Like, they could drink and then train next day and they... But he could do it all.
Really?
But he used to say, I'm better without it. I'll just go running. He's like, I'm better without the ball than what I am with it.
He'd actually say that, yeah.
And don't get me wrong, his quality on the ball was brilliant. And he always used to say he was slow. But I'm yet to see somebody beat him for pace. Yet to see somebody beat him for pace. And I was at a game when Hibs played years ago. I think it was 2006. I might be wrong. Ivan Sproul scored a hat-trick at Ibrox. Hibs beat Rangers 3-0. And Brunier's ran away from Lovenkranz twice. Now, Peter Lovenkranz was rapid for Rangers. And Brunier's left him for dead.
Really, yeah.
And Brunier never, ever lost his pace. He gradually got a little bit slower, but he was still rapid. And I'm talking, he's hitting full speed. He's hitting 34, 35 kilometres an hour. Full speed. And he's thinking he's slow.
It's dread to think what I am then.
I've seen boys at 35, Celtic, I've seen boys at 35, 36. It's insane how quick some boys are. Yeah. My quickest, I think I clocked 34 point something, 34.3. I think that was my quickest I've ever clocked.
Right.
I've seen boys clock 36.2, 36.3 in games. But yeah, Bruni he's a character, very, very funny guy. But on the pitch, he was an animal.
There was two things I remember of Brown that got me buzzing when I saw them. One was, I think they were playing Aberdeen. Someone fouls him. He's on the floor. And then another Aberdeen player comes in. I'm pretty sure it's Aberdeen. And smacks the ball at him.
Yeah, yeah.
And he gets up. And he does
it like
that towards the fans. And I watched it that a million times.
The boy got sent off for that, you know.
Did he get sent?
He got sent off for the first challenge, yeah. Because where he's caught him like inside his thigh. And then I remember... Shea Logan, him and Bruno had been having spat for a while, and he's the one that smashes the ball off Bruno's back. But I don't even think Bruno knows that the ball got smashed off his back.
Like, he jumped up.
I think he's just obviously he's had the challenge. The rest came in, blah blah, and he's got up. He's like, right, I'm fine. I'm ready to go. Let's go.
Gives it the old one of them, didn't he? To this.
And it wasn't until after the game you look at his leg and he's like, mate, that's a dillion, that man. That's a dillion.
And the other one is there's a picture. I think the Celtic team are in Russia or somewhere cold.
And he's got a T-shirt on.
He's got a T-shirt.
We'd never ever put a
like there's players, yeah, honestly, like that, shivering. And he's like that, just in a T-shirt, just walking through. Didn't even look cold.
He always used to say that. I was like, why do you never, like, it could be snowing. And stuff. He's like, why do you never get, like, put a jumper on? He's like, you're going to end up taking it off when you start running about. He's like, so the quicker you run about, the quicker you get one. Kieran Tierney does it now as well. You'll never see Kieran Tierney with a jumper on.
Really?
Yeah. And that's what people at Arsenal say. He's like, he's nuts. He's insane. Like John McGinn as well. John McGinn, it was pelting down the rain when he was at Aston Villa. Pelting down the rain, snow on the ground, blah, blah, blah. And he's walking in with flip-flops, shorts and T-shirt.
Insane.
It's like Scottish are built different, man.
Yeah. You,
we're all built different. And now I see where it is and it drops like to 14 degrees. I'm like, ah, fucking give me a jumper, man. Yeah. I'm freezing. Yeah. Absolutely. I walked home last night with my girls. My girls obviously had like little dresses on. And I stayed about 15 minutes. And I'm looking, I've got a jumper on, I've got a shirt, jeans, shoes. And I get home, I'm like, get the heating on now. I'm so cold. Nuts. Like, the weather here is different, but it's because back in Scotland, the temperature never ever drops as much as it drops here. So it could be like 25 degrees during the day, but drop to like 8 degrees at night. It's a massive drop.
Yeah.
And that's when you feel it. Whereas back in Scotland or England, you could have your best day 18 degrees. It's never going to drop 10, 15 degrees by the time you go home.
Yeah.
Maybe during the night at 2, 3 o'clock in the morning. But it's never like, if you're out having a day session on a Sunday, you're at 2 o'clock, so you end up going home at 10. It's never, you're still going to walk home, you're still going to be like nice and okay. Here it's different, man.
Yeah, it is. It is.
I've never experienced a country like it. And people think, oh, you should be used to this. Whereas like, well, I'm fucking used to Australian weather now, so.
Who was the best player you ever played with?
Played with? Oh, there's a few. Bruno would be one of them. Callum McGregor. Kieran Tierney. Roger Van Dijk.
What was Van Dijk like?
A Rolls Royce guy, man. Never came out first gear. Insane. Like, massive. It's weird because I've seen him score 3 free kicks for Celtic and he gets nowhere near free kicks for Liverpool. Now, if you go on YouTube, you can watch him later. It's three free kicks he scores. He scores one against Hibs, one against Inverness in the Scottish Cup semi-final, and one against Dundee away. And I'm like, how? And then I watch Liverpool games and I get Alexander Arnold's unreal at free kicks, blah. But I've seen Alexander Arnold have a few howlers. I'm thinking, right, how come you're not stepping up here? Like, because you've got that in the locker to smash one in from 25 yards. Why are you not doing it? But yeah, Rolls Royce of a player. Didn't think he ever came out of first gear. And yeah, obviously, seeing him what his career's had now. And you always knew, like, you were going straight to the top.
You could tell that when he was at Celtic,
And he was still, 22, 23 at the time at Celtic. And you're thinking, mate, you're not going to be here for long, man. Wait, it's just, like, what club are you going to go to?
Yeah.
That was like, you could have just lined up clubs and said, right, pick your club, where are you going?
Wow. Who was the toughest opponent?
Fucking hell. A few. I remember playing Champions League games. My first Champions League game I started in the group stage was PSG at home. I remember the game the day before. Brendan Rodgers said the two centre halves are going to be Marquinhos and Thiago Silva. So I want you to get that Thiago Silva because he's not as quick anymore. 35, 36. Legs have gone. Now, my preseason, I've been doing really well.
Yep.
Legs have gone. You're doing for pace. Couldn't get near him.
Really?
Him and Marquinhos could not get near them. The team they had that night, they battered us 5-0 at Celtic Park, was insane. Front three of Mbappe, Neymar and Cavani. Who's the middle two? The middle three. Verratti, Rabiot and Draxler.
Mate. You know when you play them, you just go levels like that's...
It was weird because Neymar brought out a signature boot and they were blue. And he was wearing them that night. Now, I'm superstitious. I need to be the last player from my team out the tunnel. So was he.
Really? Yeah.
So we're walking out, and I've just looked down, and I've got like I've looked at him, and he's looked at me, like, and we've both looked at each other's shoes, and I've got his fucking boots on. And I'm like, ah, this guy must think I'm a right dick, man. Like, just like, could you not just wear like a normal pair of papers? No, I need to wear his. And yeah, but him and Bruni had a bit of a spat before because Bruni and them playing Barcelona before. So him and Bruni had a bit of needle between them.
Neymar and Brown.
Neymar and Bruni, yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, that night they tore us apart, man. Couldn't get near him. Cavani scored one of the best headers I've seen. So I've been back stick and it's like the balls went past him and he's just like flicked it back and it just went straight as a die and off the side net. And it's not until you watch the replay, like, how the f*** did you do that?
Yeah.
That's not most of the levels I play in that. Yeah. That's why he's went on to have the careers had.
What an experience playing in games like that.
Trying to get next to Verratti plays two touch. It was like somebody told him you can't play more than two touch.
Really?
Yeah. I don't think he took more than two touches any time he touched the ball. One touch pass. I'm like, what the fuck? Yeah. Can't get near them.
You played against Messi as well, huh?
Yeah, pre-season friendly, yeah. We were playing them in Dublin. Which is weird. Him and I'm sure it was, I don't know if it was Suarez, I just signed there. Obviously, we were travelling over, and the question was, are they going to bring any superstars over? And then we found out Messi was coming over, and I was like, I need to start this game. If this guy's playing, like, obviously, I've been doing the handshakes and stuff, I'm going to end up shaking this guy's hand. And I used to have it as my Facebook profile picture all the time, with me and him shaking each other's hands, because it was obviously my son, he's a football fan, and it wasn't until after the game, I was like, look, your dad got a picture of today. And he's like, who? And I showed him, he's like, no way. He's like, that's fake, no way, how's that? That's fake. I was like, you know what's even better? And I was like, your dad scored that game as well.
Unreal. I scored.
Yeah, it was a mistake for the centre-half, and fucking, he took a bad touch, and I was trying and smashed in 1-0, but we ended up getting beat 3-1, but.
Hey, I would be, if I was you, I'd be walking around, I'm going, I played against Messi and I scored, that's it. I just had that, that's unreal. Unreal.
I actually got, like, they never had any names on the back of the strips, but I got Suarez's strip that game. He was wearing number 9, yeah. So I got, obviously I was wearing number 9 at the time, so yeah. I got his strip after the game, but I've got a fair few strip collections.
Who have you got in your strip collection?
I've got Lewandowski, Aguero, Ibrahimovic, Van Persie. Gundogan.
Player. Love.
I know. I never played Barcelona. I never played against Barcelona in the Champions League. I was injured both games. Managed to play against Man City. That's how I got Aguero and stuff.
Yeah.
Cavani, I've got his strip. I got his strip at the home game. Rabiot got his strip at away game. Jerome Boateng.
Yeah.
Got his. I've got Mats Hummels when we played Germany for Scotland. Yeah, I've got a fair few.
What was it like representing your country?
Best thing you can do.
First call up, how do you feel?
First call up was weird because we had a interim manager, Billy Stark. So the manager got sacked and he was in my 21s manager, and they asked him to take, it was a friendly against Luxembourg away. I'd been doing well. And my house manager phoned me and said, Billy Stark's trying to phone you. I was like, okay, why? I'm too old to play for 21s now. So he phoned me, he's like, look, a couple of injuries, why don't you come up to the national side? We're going to obviously play Luxembourg, we want you involved. Fucking hell, this is like Scotland first team, this is massive, this.
Unreal.
And it wasn't until like later on you play, the manager comes in, you get selected near enough every time, you're getting involved, you're playing games, you get minutes. And it wasn't until obviously my first goal against England that I was like, right, this is it, this is where you send everybody mad. I had chances before, I had missed one. I remember playing against Slovakia or Slovenia, I always get them two mixed up. But I missed from like 2 yards out, across the Robert Snodgrass, across the wall, and I've like tried to volley it as hard as I could, and I smashed it off a bar, and I was thinking, I'm never ever going to score for my country here, ever. And then England's next, it was in March, and England game was in June.
Two free kicks.
It was on my son's birthday as well, so I can't ever forget it. Two free kicks, yeah, it was same game.
Yeah, two free kicks. It was mad. I was fuming. I was raging.
It was mad because, like, we were doing all right in the game. Obviously, England had their superstars playing in the game, and we were doing all right. It was dogged. Like, we weren't getting a lot of the ball, but we were defending well. We scored. Oxlade-Chamberlain scored, and it took like a wicked deflection past Craigie. I still don't understand why he's not got a hat on, because the sun's beating down on his face. I think if he has a hat on and he sees a ball, he might get it, but he's kind of, the ball's in the back of the net and he's like fucking swiveled already to try and block it. And obviously we made a few subs and stuff, and then I seen the strip, Chris Martin getting warmed up and then strip off, and I'm like, right, okay, time's up. And we go with two up front, and I'm like, okay, I was like, this is all right. Obviously, time's ticking on, 87th minute. they got like Ryan Fraser goes down. Gary Cahill. It's weird because if you watch a replay of this, Gary Cahill kicks Ryan Fraser, and Gary Cahill goes down as if he's been shot. And I'm thinking, please tell me you want to try to win a free kick there for yourself. I was like, you've just about took his head off,
yeah,
and you're trying to get a free kick.
Yeah.
Anyway, we've got the free kick, and I've placed it, and the sun is in my eyes, and I'm just thinking, right, just please hit the target. Just don't balloon it. Hit it over. I've hit it over the wall, and as soon as it's over the wall, I start running. I know it's in. I'm just waiting for the net to rip over to start celebrating. Muck up my celebration. I try and do a knee slide, and the fucking ground's so dry. It's and I try and knee slide, and I bounce off my knee and end up doing a forward roll. And I'm just thinking, right, first goal for Scotland secured against England. It's not actually realised until after the game how big scoring against England was. So anyway, we get the ball back in, we flick up to big Chris Martin. I went on. Get to Chris Martin. Chris Martin's, I'm sure he slips. Oh, no. I'm sure it was Chris Small and he slips. And I think it catches Chris Martin. I'm not sure if it actually did. But obviously, after the foul was given, Eric Dyer and everybody saying he slipped. How can you give a foul because he slipped? I'm thinking, I'm the ball if he's fucking slipped or not. Give me the ball because I'm hitting that again. But Stuart Armstrong, who I was at Celtic with at the time, he's like, I fancy this one. I was like, Stuart, don't even think about me. I was like, I've just popped one on the other side. I was like, if I get over this wall, this side, I was like, it goes in again. And literally, I put it down. The ref blows the whistle. But I just run up, curl it over. And I just, as soon as it passes Harry Kane's head, I'm like, I'm off again. I was like, I start running again. I'm like, I've done it again. I've done it again. And I do it again. Kind of similar to my heart celebration. I run one way and then just run all the way past the England fans. And I'm just, honestly, I just end up stopping. I was like, I'm fucking knackered. I was like, yes. And Bruni comes and grabs me in a headlock, blah, blah, blah. And you just see how angry he was because, obviously, Scotland-England rivalry, blah, blah, blah. And I'm thinking, why? Like, not after you realise it briefly. I'm like, why are you so angry? Like, calm down. It's just, obviously, scoring that game was unreal. But, you know, if we had held it, it would have been unreal.
Yeah.
Messi or whatever. I honestly felt like a defeat when Harry Kane scored. The ball in the box was floated in. Obviously, a lot of people say, Craig, you should come and try and claim it or try and punch it, blah, blah, blah. But Harry Kane hadn't done what he's done his full career. Great finish, the back stick, size foot, opens it up, boom, goal. And I'm thinking, I literally dropped to my knees. And I remember Kyle Walker running past me and going, get it up, you. And I'm like, you're a dick.
Did you give it him some?
I couldn't. I had no energy left. The sun was, honestly, it was a day like this. Absolutely scorching hot, and I was just thinking, I've got nothing left. I was like, I just ran, put our team 2-1 up, and then they scored and equalised. I'm like, oh. I honestly felt like a defeat. And afterwards, I went to a wedding, I got invited to a wedding. My mates were all at a wedding. They said, look, well, I was going to say, but you know, if you've got a spare hour, come up, have a few drinks with the boys, blah, blah, blah. It wasn't until I walked in the place erupted when I walked in.
Did it?
I got a bigger reception. Boys were saying, you got a bigger reception than what the fucking bride and groom just got. Like the videos I got sent, obviously, this was a couple of mates I've known from football back home. A few of my other mates were in this Highlander bar in Ibiza. He texted me saying, mate, you've just turned the Highlander bar upside down. It's really? Like ridiculous. So a lot of videos you see, obviously, then Scotland put up videos and fans were taking videos of the second goal from their house, wherever they were. It's mad to see.
Yeah. That's some feeling.
It was. It was just getting off the mark for Scotland because I didn't think I was ever going to do it. Obviously, the chance I'd missed. And then, obviously, scoring 2-1 game for 2-3 minutes really was ideal.
Unreal, mate. I do want to ask you about the tying the scarf to the post. And did you intentionally wipe the bogeys on the flag?
So tying the scarf on the post, I don't know actually what made me do that, to be honest. I remember the Celtic, obviously, after we played Rangers at Ibrox, the scarf's got tossed. When we were celebrating at the far end, scarves are getting tossed on, we're obviously hanging. And I just went, you know what, I'm just tying this. Like, bit of a statement here. It's not as if I can go and get a big fucking massive flag and stick it in the centre circle, do you know what I mean? Bit of a statement. It just became a thing. I only ever done it when we played Rangers at Ibrox, or at Hampden if we won a trophy. But I remember one game we played at Linfield away. Now, I was getting dogs abuse, obviously. Linfield's like a massive Rangers culture. And I was taking a corner, and they were giving me dogs abuse. And we had just beat... Last time we played Rangers, we beat them 5-1 at Ibrox. Obviously, corner comes in, they were giving me dogs, and I was like, I go like this, behind me. Next thing, a buck fastball comes flying past me.
Really, yeah.
And I'm like, oh, yeah, fucker. So I go and pick her up and show the ref. I get booked.
For what?
Picking the bottle up. So I pick the bottle up, hand it to the ref, and the ref books me. I'm like, mate, I've just about been killed by a buck fastball getting thrown from a crowd, and you want to book me? I was like, nah. I'll literally run back, put the ball in the corner flag, and smash it in the corner. That was it. And then after the game, I was like, nah, fuck this. I'm not getting away with this. So I think Celtic had about 100, 150 fans. They never took a lot over the Linfield. I think they obviously knew it was going to be dangerous.
Yeah.
So obviously fans came over, and I'd say to one of the stewards, I didn't think the stewards noticed at the time, but I said, "Can that guy's going to give me a scarf. Can I get the scarf, please?" So he'd run over and give me. I was like, I need to put them straight to the post. Bosh. You go on YouTube, you type this in. I'm no kidding you. They had to get the army across the corner area. The fans were going to kill me. Like, I probably can't set foot back in Windsor Park without getting it doing. Like, somebody would do me in.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nuts. I would, if I ever played for Scotland again, touch wood to do, I don't think I will, but if I ever played Northern Ireland and we played them at Windsor Park, I couldn't go. There'd be people waiting at the hotel, airport, outside the stadium for me.
Wow.
At the time, I thought it was funny. I end up getting a ban from UEFA as well. UEFA gave me a one-game ban.
Is that what it was for you? Just funny, like.
Just, yeah, I just thought it was funny. And there was never ever any intention of being like malicious or I just like
just for fun.
Yeah, just a bit of banter.
What about the bogeys on the flag?
So the bogey was, I don't even think I had a bogey. I wiped my nose. There was nothing on it.
Just
to make it look like I wiped the bogey. But obviously, there was one that always sticks in my throat because everybody says that when I was walking, in, I spat on the Rangers crest on the floor. I've never ever done that. I never would.
Right.
I spit. Obviously, I got a lot of phlegm, blah blah. But I've never spat on the Rangers crest. So I think they made up the rumor that we've seen him spit on the crest. I just want to clear that. That's never ever happened. I've done things at Rangers that I probably shouldn't have. But that's not one of them.
That's just a rumour.
Yeah. I mean, the rumours are... Okay, the rumours about me is ridiculous, but... Yeah, that's one of the rumours that I don't like, man. I mean, there's a lot of them I don't like, but... One of the ones that I spat on the crest and just as you walk out, I've never... That's never, ever happened.
It's tough when... Again, I'm trying to look at it from a high-profile footballer's point of view. If you read or see something that you know just completely isn't true... And people are going to, a lot of football fans are going to believe. I'm guessing Rangers fans are going to want to believe that you did it because they want a reason to hate you even more. How does it feel when you read rumours that you know just aren't true but are being written? Do you get to a stage of your career where you go...
You can't retaliate because 9 times out of 10 you see the rumours on social media. And the minute you tweet back, you get 200, 300, 400 people replying to you. Like, why are you biting, blah, blah. I'm like, ah. But they're saying stuff that aren't true. Like, that ends up going in the paper. But then, thinking about when you reply, that's when it goes in the paper. So, obviously, the newspaper articles aren't going to go and look at your everyday bricky who's fucking saying, oh, the Leigh Griffiths done this, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But see, when I respond, that's when I go in the paper. Leigh Griffiths responds to rumour that he's done this. It's not until later on in life I've just had to learn to let it go, regardless of what the rumour is, from it being cokehead to fucking anything else. I'm like, where are you getting these rumours from? Like, show me one piece of evidence that you've got that tells me I'm this. They can't.
Because it's just one... idiot that makes it up.
Yeah, but obviously with the injury and stuff, and obviously when I went off of my mental health, they were saying, oh, he's failed a drug test. I've not failed. I've never took drugs in my life. I'm happy to take a lie detector test to anybody. Take a piss test. But I've always stated on record that when the piss test comes back and it's clear, the person who accused me drinks it. That's it.
Yeah.
and let's see if they want to go through with it. Because I guarantee you they wouldn't. They're all happy to sit on social media and give me X, Y, and Z abuse about being a like failed drug test or taking this drug or that drug. Never took drugs in my life, nor smoked in my life. But somehow I'm a junkie and I'm this and I'm that, and I've failed umpteen drug tests, and that's why I went off, and it wasn't my mental health. That was a cover up.
How was it that time when you were dealing with your mental health? Did you get the support that you needed?
Yeah, Celtic were unreal at that point. Brendan Rodgers, obviously, a lot of things happened that I'm not going to go into. It was a bit deep. But Brendan Rodgers picked up Caitlin at the house and brought her to the hospital. But I didn't notice at the time. I was trying to obviously check myself out of the hospital. I said, look, I just want to go home. Just get to my bed and just wake up. Basically, I think, like, what I did that night, I was thinking, right, I'm just going to go to sleep, wake up tomorrow, and I'm going to go to training and try and figure it out. Not knowing that Brendan and Caitlin in the next room. I go home, Brendan comes in and speaks and says, look, you need to take time off. You need to get your head right. We need you back fit. We need you back playing. Right, okay. And then it wasn't until he ends up leaving in February time to go to Leicester. Neil Lennon comes back. And then I'm obviously speaking with liaison officers, blah, blah. So I'm going to training at Lennox Town at night when like the first team are away, reserves are away, and then if the women's team or young boys are training at night at Lennox Town, I need to wait on them or go to a separate part of the building. So I'm going there at like 7 o'clock at night, doing what I can, and then it's not until a month later I'm starting to get back to see the first team boys gradually and start doing exercises in the afternoon with the coaching staff rather than waiting till at night and doing it on my own. And then we win the Scots Cup final, and Neil Lennon says to me, look, go away, get ready for like pre-season. You're going to be back, you're going to be playing, but I want your head right. I want you to get properly fixed. And yeah, I came back that season, or the pre-season, started off really well.
So in that time there, were you struggling to manage everything personal and football? It just got on top of you, and then was that break the break that you needed to just reset?
Yeah, I don't even think football was like a release kind of thing. It's like I was just afterwards, it's going back, and yeah, that was family problems and stuff like that. There was a lot of stuff that were gone on my mind, and it was just fucking, I was just trying to get to the problem with that and trying to forget about things that had happened in the past, which again, I won't ever forget. I can't ever forget because it happened with one of my family members, and even now it's hard to talk about, but it just gets me angry when I do talk about it.
Yeah.
Because it was right under my nose, and I never knew about it, and then I got lied to for umpteen years before I ended up finding out. And then once I found out, it was just fucking, like, all hell broke loose in my mind, man.
And you need that time to take that in, I guess, and deal with that.
Aye, but obviously it was hard to process. It's still hard to process now when you have to think back about it.
Right.
But I've learned to forget and not forgive.
Okay.
Rather than forget and forgive. Yeah. I've done one and not the other. I can't forgive for what happened. But for the rest of it, nah, it's just the time off was ideal. So it was just trying to get back gradually, and then, you know, when it came to pre-season, just work as hard as you can to get back.
Absolutely. And we're just going to wrap up with how you're feeling with, is it Mandura?
Mandura, yeah.
I got slated last night. I called it Mandura.
That's what I first called it. Mandura. Mandura. I call it Manja. Because I don't know, so many things, so many names that people call it. But yeah, Mandura.
Are you enjoying it here?
Best move I've done.
Really? Yeah.
Yeah. Just like I said to you in a podcast, that to have that life again, just to go about and just do things and just be a number and not a name. It's changed my life, and it's obviously, I'm hoping when I speak to the kids on the long flight back home, I'm hoping they're going to say, Dad, we've seen a different side of you. We love seeing you like this. And we can't wait to come back out and see you again. And for me, that's going to be the hard part because I need to go back in September. I'll see them probably for a couple of days. But then after that, it's like, right, I'm not going to see them for 4 or 5 months.
Yeah.
Towards Christmas time, maybe just after. And for me, apart from Caitlin, my kids are my life. And after, like, it's weird, like, the kids have been here for just nearly 3 weeks. The kids before were here just nearly 3 weeks. So it's like, I'm going to go back to a house being so quiet. And that, for me, I'll probably take a good 3-4 weeks to get used to that and get my mind straight and thinking, right, the kids haven't come back for a few months now, so you need to get back on track and get ready for enjoying your time off, but get ready and go again pre-season, because for me, I never had that last season. Never had a proper pre-season, so I'm looking forward to obviously hopefully getting to the NPL with the boys and then pre-season ready to go.
Nah, it's quality, mate. I want to say thank you again for taking the time to come today, especially with your kids being here. I'm going to say it again. It was really good to see you last night with your kids dancing, having a good time. I know myself and Brad really appreciate that.
You better not fucking recording me dancing last night.
Definitely not. I took a step back and
the Macarena was on point, you know.
You've got some good moves, but people will just have to take my word for it. I've got no recordings. So, Leigh, quality, mate. Thanks a lot.
Top man.
Right, legends. If you're at this point of the video, that means you're enjoying my content. So make sure that you hit the subscribe button, you hit the like button, and you hit the little notification bell so you don't miss any of my up-and-coming videos.